Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Manish, for such a warm welcome. And I'm sure at the outset, I want to thank everyone who's come when such a beautiful weather is going on, you know, to go out and enjoy, to listen to a talk. And I have a feeling that even if the crowd is not too much, even if 5 people attend, it's worth it. Because whatever information you carry from here, it will disseminate into the family, into the society. So the crowd strength never really matters. So I hope you enjoy this session. And as Manish said, I wanted to club both of these topics together because both are lifestyle diseases. And there are many factors which are common. So I didn't want to really keep a separate session for both of them. Now, how much are we aware? Now, hypertension and diabetes, these are very, very common things which everyone knows about, at least what is hypertension and diabetes. But from where are we becoming aware? The commonest source nowadays is the internet and the newspapers, which carry so much information and sometimes such contradictory information that you're yourself puzzled regarding what is the right information. So it is not just gathering information, but knowing which is the right information and clearing your concepts and misconceptions about this disease, which is important. Another group of patients who are like, they have all the information, but as Mr. Gurdeep Singh rightly said, they always feel, I will not be affected with this. It is the other class of patients who will be getting hypertension, diabetes. I should just be aware of it. This will never affect me. So it's very important that we gather the right kind of knowledge and then monitor ourselves. So what I thought, when we start this session, we'll have a small quiz so that everyone gets involved with the session. And let's see how much of us are aware of things which are going around us. I think this is simple. Which is the diabetes capital of the world? Yeah. So India is leading with almost 31.7 million population affected with diabetes, almost 40 million. And it is expected by the year 2025, almost 70 million people will be affected with diabetes. So this is the load of diabetes in India. This is followed by China and then the US. So Asian countries are leading in lifestyle diseases. One, mainly because of the genetics which they possess, and now with the lifestyle which they are taking up. Now, what is the percentage of asymptomatic patients who suffer from hypertension? Any guesses? Yeah, without any symptom. They may be having hypertension, but they have no idea that they have blood pressure. So you'll be shocked to know, 60 to 70%. Almost 67% of the patients are unaware that they have hypertension. Now, I think even this you should be able to answer. Complications occur after how many years of diabetes? At diagnosis. So almost 25% of the patients will already have the complication when they are diagnosed as diabetes. So that's the reason there's such an importance to be aware of these diseases and to diagnose them early so that we can prevent the complications. There is no point diagnosing at a stage when you already have a complication. And these are preventable diseases. One more question, the last one, I suppose. What is the target blood pressure we should look at? 120. Yeah, so generally what we say is it should be 130 by 85 for a person who does not have diabetes and ischemic heart disease, and it should be 120 by 80 for a person who has a diabetes and hypertension, ischemic heart disease. So now I thought, just go to the next thing. Like, did you know certain shocking facts? Diabetes causes.
Go back to the previous one and explain what's the difference between?
Yeah, see, normally till now people, everyone had an idea of cutoff of 140 by 90, but it is not so. In a person who doesn't have any other illnesses like a diabetes or a ischemic heart disease, we aim for 130 by 85. And a person who has diabetes and ischemic heart disease, our aim should be to keep the blood pressure at 120-80.
Ischemic heart disease?
Heart disease. Like anyone who has a heart attack, blocks, plasties done, or CABG done. Normal. They consider that it is normal, but it is not a normal blood pressure. It should be less than that. Yeah. So I thought I'll just give you some shocking facts. Yeah.
Does it change with the age also?
I will get to it. That's why I think we'll keep all the questions at the end, because I have covered a lot of points. In fact, the end part is all about simple questions which patients come and ask me daily during my OPDs. So most of your questions will be answered during that session. If there's anything else remaining, then we'll discuss at the end. So it was really shocking to know that diabetes causes almost 6 deaths every minute in this world. 1 in 20 deaths due to all causes is due to diabetes. Hypertension and diabetes is the number one cause of renal failure, patient requiring dialysis and transplant. And non-alcoholic liver disease, which is cirrhosis, what we talk about in common language, or liver failure. Now the first cause is diabetes, hyperlipidemia, means increased cholesterol in the body, and obesity. This is the leading cause of liver failure now. There are hardly patients, means of course we do find alcoholic liver disease, but this is the most commonest cause of liver failure now. And we see it in very, very young population also. They are definitely at risk. Yeah, so my topic I have divided into hypertension, diabetes. I'll be dealing with very simple things regarding these diseases, not going too much into detail about the medical science involved in it, more to just to give an idea about what it is, what are the symptoms, what are the treatments available. And then at the end, as I told you, I'll be discussing a lot of common questions which are frequently asked to doctors. So what do we understand by blood pressure? It is a pressure of blood in the arteries which are being pumped by your heart. This blood passes through various branches of the artery which supply blood to various parts of the body. Now when we measure blood pressure, there are two readings which we get. The first one is the higher one, which is a systolic blood pressure, and the second one is the diastolic blood pressure. So whenever we ask patient what is their blood pressure, they generally are not really aware sometimes, you know, which reading to say. So we have to mention both the readings, and both the readings are important. Now how do we measure? Which is the simplest method of measuring is the manual sphygmomanometer with the mercury, and that is the best method to measure the blood pressure. We have many digital apparatus, electronic ones which have come up, but they are not really very reliable, and I discourage all patients from using these apparatus because that increases anxiety of their own mind, their family members, and even the doctor, because they make go on making phone calls to the doctor, my blood pressure is now this and now it is that. So the best way to measure is by the manual one. Now it is very important to know that your BP is not going to be constant all the time. It varies. So when you are running, it's a different blood pressure. When you are resting, it's a different blood pressure. When you are sleeping, it is different. Even in both the limbs, there may be a difference of about 10 millimeters. Okay? Unless you have unequal pulses, there'll be a big difference in the blood pressure. But otherwise, your BP will be almost same in both the limbs. Now, how do we classify blood pressure? This is according to the JNC 7 classification. So, optimal blood pressure here, they have given as 120-80. Pre-hypertension is the stage where you will not be labeled as hypertension, but you're almost at it. So less than 140 and 90, Hypertension, when we classify this patient, we classify them into stage 1 and 2. Stage 1 is less than 160 and 100, while stage 2 is more than 160, 100. Now, why is there a need to, you know, classify them into stage 1 and stage 2? Because when I see a patient with stage 1, I will give him a monotherapy, a single drug. While when I see a patient with stage 2, I will, you know, start off with a combination therapy for such patients, because one drug is not going to help them. Now, when you talk about the epidemiology of hypertension, it is prevalent in around 20% of adults. The incidence increases as we age, and almost 50% of us will be hypertensive by the age of 65. As we all can see, because of our lifestyle, this disease is more prevalent in the urban population than in the rural population. Now, what are the causes? Majorityly, patient, there is no cause for blood pressure. It is called as essential hypertension, idiopathic or primary. Now, there are other conditions where you may get blood pressure due to some other disease. Very commonly, kidney patients, because they have a renin-angiotensin system, and whenever they suffer from kidney, this is crude and they get blood pressure. This is the very high blood pressure which they get, and a very difficult one to control. There are certain diseases in which there are increased steroid hormones or catecholamines which are released into your body system, endocrine diseases, and they can cause hypertension. And there are certain drugs like OCPILs. Patients who have been on steroids for some other reason, they can develop blood pressure. Other common thing what we see is patients who are on chronic painkillers, NSAIDs, ibuprofen, Voveran, diclofenac, aspirin. These are the patients who suffer kidney damage and then get blood pressure. Of course, family history does play a role. A person who has a strong family history of hypertension has a more tendency to develop a hypertension, but not necessarily that he's going to develop. But this person has to be more vigilant about keeping the other risk factors, like the lifestyle influences, which affect and cause hypertension. So this person should keep the weight in check, should keep the lipids in check, because they have more chances of developing hypertension than a person who does not have a family history. But a person who does not have a family history doesn't mean that he will never get hypertension. Now, I think all of us are living with this stress, the work, family, children, tension, pressure of job, everything which is adding to the stress. These are the commonest causes why we are getting to see these illnesses in much more younger population. Earlier, hypertension, diabetes was a disease where, you know, after 50 or 60, we would think about it. But now, almost people as young as 20s and 30s, we are finding patients with hypertension, diabetes. In fact, there are so many angioplasties which are done in 30s. Stress, sedentary lifestyle, because of all the conveniences which we have to really think about that we need to walk now. Because everything else is done, you know, with a car, everything is home delivered, so you don't have to move about for anything. So now we have to take out time to go for a walk. The situation has come such. Obesity, because of all the other factors, the food which we're eating, the fast food which has come into our market, the sedentary lifestyle, all this is adding to obesity. It is seen in younger population. We are seeing a lot of adolescent obese children, and they are becoming more and more prone for all these diseases. Now, I thought I'll just discuss a few things about this, because there are a lot of misconceptions even about this. White coat hypertension. There are certain patients, the moment they come into my room, they tell me, "Doctor, please don't check my blood pressure. It is going to be high." So these are people who suffer from white coat hypertension. The moment they enter the doctor's room, their BP rises. And the moment they're out, their BP is normal. So really not to worry about this white coat hypertension, because it really doesn't cause much harm. So no, otherwise they will have a normal blood pressure. Second is the isolated systolic hypertension. This is what we see in the elderly. Because of increased resistance of the blood vessels, the peripheral blood vessels, because of aging, atherosclerosis, there's a lot of resistance. So the systolic blood pressure rises in them. and the diastolic, the lower value, is normal or even below normal. So this is seen in elderly. This also requires treatment. Though it is commonly seen in the elderly population, it is still not a normal blood pressure. And all these patients will require treatment. Third is pregnancy-induced hypertension. Females who develop hypertension during the last trimester. And in 90% of the cases, everything will be normal once the baby is delivered. But if this patient has a very strong family history of hypertension, some percentage of this may progress into chronic hypertension. And the last is the ambulatory high blood pressure. That is an entity where randomly the BP will go up and down. But again, these do come in the category of high blood pressure. So at some point, the BP will be perfectly normal. In some, it will be really high. So in such patients, generally, we put them on this 24 hours monitoring. And we see the average reading over the day. And then decide whether they require to take treatment or no. Irregular heart pumping never causes hypertension. If at all, it will cause hypotension. Because when your heart is not pumping well, the blood which enters your heart is not right. So generally, these patients will present with hypotension, less blood pressure, never hypertension. Now, what are the symptoms? As I discussed earlier, 67% of the patients have no symptoms at all. Unless you really go out of your way and get your BP checked, or doctor has checked up on some routine occasion, or you are undergoing a health check program. So most of them will be asymptomatic. Some people have headache, some have heaviness of head, some have dizziness, and some just feel uneasy. So every patient is different. There is no specific symptom of hypertension. But if you feel anything unusual, you should go and get your blood pressure checked. And majority of the patients would come with some complication, like a brain hemorrhage, a stroke, a heart failure, or a ischemic heart event. Now, why are we so concerned about this blood pressure? If there is blood pressure, with age it goes up, it is a normal physiological thing, so why are we so worried? Higher the blood pressure, the harder the heart has to work. So what happens is the left ventricle, which pumps our blood, it hypertrophies. The muscle mass increases. And at some point, it gives way and it can cause heart failure. Then because the blood is flowing at a higher pressure, it damages the organs which it reaches. The heart, the brain, the kidneys, the eyes. I've already discussed this. Also, because there is a lot of turbulence in the blood vessels, it damages the vessel walls. So it makes it more prone to block faster than a normal person. So then we suffer heart attacks, strokes. And the BP suddenly rises. We call it as accelerated hypertension or malignant hypertension. You can have hemorrhage in the eyes, in the brain, subarachnoid hemorrhage or an intracerebral bleed. And that can be really life-threatening. Now, how do we prevent? Most important thing is to undergo a regular health checkup. In fact, in one of these Pavai Planet, there was a very good article wherein a lady had come to a health check center and gone through all the packages, and she found them too costly. Then she went out from there, picked up a few things, went home shopping, ate in some good restaurant, and after a few days suffered a heart attack. And that time she was found to have hypertension, diabetes, increased cholesterol. So we really need to think that we need to spend some money on our own health. People want to bargain at the doctors, at the health check counters. But I think this is what you're doing for yourself, not for anyone else. But people tend to take their own health so much for granted and suffer a lot. So when we diagnose a patient as a mild blood pressure, generally we advise them to undergo lifestyle modification because all these are in the end lifestyle diseases. So start exercising, diet control, less salt in your diet. And whenever there's a secondary cause, like a person is on steroids, is on some other medications which is causing, then treatment of that disease itself will take care of the hypertension. Now, what is the non-drug treatment which is available? Reduction of overweight, reduction of alcohol intake, and treat the other coexisting risk factors like smoking, increased cholesterol, and diabetes if it is there. Now, what are the diet recommendations? Have a healthy and a well-balanced diet. We should reduce the salt intake to about 4 grams per day. There should be no added salt over fruits, salads, certain things which naturally contain more salt, like pickles, peppers. These should be avoided in diet. And all processed food, all frozen food has increased soda bicarb. So that all needs to be avoided. Also increase the intake of fruits and vegetables, which has a lot of potassium. And increased potassium is known to be helpful, and it helps in keeping the hypertension in control. And lower intake of fat and saturated fat. Now, when we start a medicine, there is no algorithm or a fixed guideline for which medicine to be started first. So many times it is doctor who decides which medicine you need to start, and with the doctor, whatever they are comfortable with, they will start first. Of course, there are certain indications where we need to start specific medication. There are different classes of antihypertensive drugs like beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, calcium channel blockers and things. So whenever a patient has a migraine, we prefer to start a beta blocker so that it will cover the migraine as well as the hypertension. If the patient has hypertension, I would use an ACE inhibitor because it has a renal protective action. If the patient has a heart disease, then beta blockers work well, so we will add that drug. So every patient is individual and the treatment is tailor-made for every patient. Plus, every patient may have different side effects of the drugs. You can never predict that when you start amlodipine, you will develop a swelling in the feet. So some develop, some don't, but there is nothing really to predict whether you will develop this or no. So it is by trial and error. You need to visit your doctor again and again so that in the initial phase, you have to be regular with your doctor so that you can optimize the treatment. And once the treatment is optimized, your BP is under control, you're tolerating the drug well, then you can visit your doctor every 3 months, 6 months, but keep on checking your blood pressure in between. Now, how to keep your heart healthy and alive? First and foremost, we should aim for is a primary prevention. Secondary prevention comes when all the damage is already done. But it doesn't mean that you don't start prevention at that stage. We should. But we should always aim at primary prevention. So be a non-smoker, eat a low-fat diet, keep a check on your blood pressure, treat the associated risk factors, exercise regularly, be active, keep a healthy weight and avoid stress. For secondary prevention, lifestyle modification, all of this will continue. And along with it, you will have to take medications. If there's a block, angioplasty and stent needs to be done. If it is severe disease and cannot be angioplasty cannot be done, then you need to undergo bypass. And you have to accept the disease. Most of the patients live in denial that I don't have a disease. When a patient comes to my room, we always ask, what are the other medications they're taking? Do you suffer from hypertension, diabetes? No, doctor, nothing. I have normal blood pressure. Then you start writing the list of drugs. Any medications you're on? Yes, I'm taking this for blood pressure, I'm taking this. Then why don't you come up? That, yes, doctor, I have hypertension, I have. Patients want to be in denial. That is the truth. So always accept and always tell your doctor that you have these problems. Now going on to the next lifestyle disease, diabetes. In simple language, it is increased sugar in the body or the blood. Now, commonly we divide this into two types of diabetes. One is the type 1 and other one is the type 2. What we normally see in this population is the type 2 diabetes, which is the non-insulin dependent. Type 1 is the insulin dependent. It generally comes at a very young age. Due to some reason, the pancreas failed to produce insulin. And generally, children are affected up to adolescent. Rarely we may see one case in the young adulthood or something. But generally they would come in at a very younger age. So this, there is nothing like prevention. A person who has to develop will develop. There's a genetic correlation and thing. What we generally talk about diabetes is the non-insulin dependent. That means body is producing insulin, but the insulin is not able to have an effect on the effector organs like the muscle, the liver. So obesity is the main cause in such people, and of course genetics does play a role. And in such patients, we treat them with tablets because this improves the insulin resistance. But these patients also may require insulin at a later stage, because over a period of time, your pancreas will start reducing the output of insulin. And then at some stage, when your sugars are not getting controlled with tablets, you need to add a small dose of insulin in them. Now, what are the symptoms? A person feels increased thirst, feel like drinking water more. They pass more urine. Many times what happens is they confuse this. What happens is they say, because I'm passing more urine, I'm drinking more water, or because I'm drinking more water, I'm passing urine. But they are interrelated. Second, very important thing we should know is this symptom of nocturia, passing urine in the night. So if you have to get up in the night 2-3 times to pass, a normal person would not pass urine. Or if you are used to passing once, it's okay. But if it has increased frequency in the night, then you should definitely look out for diabetes in this patient. And what happens is this thing doesn't even start immediately when your sugars go up. Normally, our kidneys do not filtrate glucose up to a level of almost 200. After that, the glucose starts going out through the glomerulus into the urine. And that is when they start developing these symptoms. But by then, already a glomerular injury has occurred, that means. Patient feels increased appetite. And as I told, almost 50% of the diabetic patients are asymptomatic, like how we see even in hypertension. And they land up with complications. They may either come with a wound which is not healing for a very long time, directly come with a heart attack, a stroke, and many other complications, or tingling, numbness in the hands, neuropathy symptoms. Now, how do we diagnose? A fasting blood glucose reading more than 100. 2 hours after meal, if you have a reading more than 140, any random reading more than 160, but this always has to be confirmed with a fasting and PP. And some patients, we label them as a impaired glucose tolerance. You will see sometimes when you do your health checkup, either the fasting reading is high, either the PP reading is high, but it is still not fitting into the definition of diabetes. But these are labeled as impaired glucose tolerance, and they should right away start off with lifestyle modification, because there are high chances at some point they will become diabetic. Now, causes of diabetes, genetic predisposition is there. If you have a strong family history, there is a high chance that you will develop diabetes. Certain infections, viral infections which affect the pancreas, can deplete you of insulin and can produce diabetes. And certain drugs like steroids and some other chemotherapeutic agents and all, they can also affect the pancreas and can cause diabetes. You'll see a lot of overlap is there between hypertension and diabetes, but I think it is worth repeating everything again, because so that it gets into our mind that we really need to look at the risk factors. Family history, obesity, habitual physical inactivity. Again, there's an entity called as gestational diabetes, females who develop diabetes during pregnancy. Again, with a strong family history, if they are obese, if they have high cholesterol, then there is a chance that they at some point will develop diabetes in their life. And any patient with an altered lipid profile. In fact, high triglycerides is one of the risk factors for developing diabetes, because excess of glucose in the body gets directly converted into triglyceride. So many times when a patient comes to me with a lipid profile report and I ask them, do you eat a lot of sweets? They are shocked. How do I know? It's because the triglycerides are very, very high. So it is not only produced with the fat, but also with a lot of carbohydrates in your diet. Now, diabetes is known to affect almost every organ in the body. And it's a silent killer. So you can see the eye, heart, kidney, nervous system, skin, any response to any stress in the body, infection, healing, everything is affected by diabetes. So when a patient has diabetes, the risk of them or the chances of, like, there are 2 persons with the same illness in the ICU. But if the person has diabetes, the chances of him recovering is much less than a person who does not, because diabetes affects a lot of other things. So in the eye, I'm just going to name a few. Diabetic retinopathy, this is one of the commonest cause of blindness in elderly population. Cataracts are known to occur faster in diabetics. They can develop increased pressure in the eye called as glaucoma. In diabetics, there is a lot of heart disease which we see. Now, a person who has diabetes, even if they have a normal cholesterol, the quality of cholesterol is not good. They are much, much more atherogenic than a person who doesn't have diabetes. So even if a person has a normal lipid profile in a diabetic patient, with statins, so that we can stabilize plaque formation. So atherosclerosis is very much increased, and it not only affects the bigger arteries, it affects the smaller. So macro as well as microvascular involvement is there. That's why sometimes in these patients, it may be very difficult to tackle the blocks, and they may be recommended to undergo CABG. Atherosclerosis means there is deposition of fat into the vessel wall, and over a period of time, the lumen becomes smaller and smaller. So the end organ, which the artery supplies, receives less blood supply, and then they suffer a heart attack, ischemia, what we say. And coronary artery disease. Very important thing when we talk about heart disease in diabetes, the symptoms are sometimes very difficult to make out. Many times these diabetes patients have nerves also affected. So they never get the typical chest pain what you find in other people. So many people get a heart attack and they are not even aware of it that they have got a heart attack. And that directly come to us with complications. In the kidney, because of the affection of the glomerular membrane, there is loss of protein. In the initial stages, it is microalbuminuria, where when you do a urine routine, you will not find any albumin there or protein. But when you check exactly for microalbuminuria, you'll find some protein. This is the earliest sign of kidney disease in diabetes. Over a period of time, the glomerular function will be affected and they may progress into renal failure. Now, one fact we have to understand that patients, you know, the creatinine it's a kidney marker and it's perfectly normal. So doctor, my kidneys are not affected with diabetes. It's not that. Our body has full capacity to compensate. Person can give one kidney and live the rest of the life normally. So we always, all our organs are double and God has given us everything extra. But we humans exhaust even that to the highest limit. And then we suffer disease. So even in diabetics, even though your creatinine is normal, your kidneys are already affected. So it is very important that once the creatinine starts rising, there is no point doing a thing, because more than 50 to 70% of your kidney function is already gone by that time when the creatinine starts showing a rise. So it is very, very important that we keep all the parameters under normal control rather than saying, oh, this is just now, you know, just above the normal limit. So I'm still not so bad. In the nervous system, either you can have affection of the small nerves which supply our limbs, the hands, legs, and you get this tingling, numbness, or you may not feel the ground when you're walking. These are all signs of neuropathy. When the blood vessels are blocked and you get a stroke, that is more of a vascular involvement of diabetes, which is causing a nervous system symptom. Skin in diabetics, it's very, very important that diabetic patients take care of their skin, because one, they don't have the sensation, so they cannot avoid an injury. Plus, when they get injured, they don't become aware of the injury very fast. So many times it is neglected. Third, the response to any injury or infection is not great. They have a very delayed healing. So in such patients, till the time they realize they have a wound, it is beyond a certain stage, and you know, it really takes time for the wound to really start healing. So you get a lot of fungal infections because there is plenty of glucose in the body, and fungal infections really thrive on this. Now, when we talk about risk factors in hypertension and diabetes, we always talk about the modifiable and the non-modifiable. Non-modifiable is a family history, age, gender. We cannot do anything about this. But there are a lot of modifiable risk factors. And if we keep all these under control, then we will have much, much less complications of the disease. So this is a repetition, but I think it's worth it. Control of weight, control of hypertension, quit smoking and alcohol, and control of lipids. Aim for fitness, maintain your weight in any form. So weight reduction helps improve the insulin sensitivity. So you'll require much less dose of medication for diabetes control. Doing your household chores or just going to work is not exercise. There has to be sustained activity for your BMR to rise. So there should be at least 30 to 45 minutes of walking or any form of cardio exercise in the day. Any other form of cardio exercise also is good enough. When we look at the food pyramid, you'll see the base is formed by carbohydrates, then comes the fruits and the vegetables, then the proteins, the meat, poultry, beans, eggs, nuts, and the tip is by the fats and the oils. So vegetables are a very good source of vitamins, minerals, phytochemicals, antioxidants, and they should be included in our diet at least 3 to 4 servings in a day. Fruits, again, the same. They are low in fat, low in sodium, high in potassium, so that helps with the blood pressure. And again, it has a lot of vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. When you talk about the proteins, it's a meat, poultry, fish, for vegetarians, the beans and the nuts. This is a very good source of protein. They have fat, but they have the polyunsaturated fat, which has omega-3 fatty acids, and it helps with the good cholesterol. Milk, yogurt, cheese, they also give a good source of protein, but they have fat into them. So the intake should be limited. Fats, oils and sweets, these are at the tip. And they provide a lot of calories, but very little nutrition. They increase your blood cholesterol, LDL, and they all decrease your HDL, which is the good cholesterol. So it is not just one food which you need to have. That is very, very important. You need to have a healthy, balanced diet. So eat a variety of foods which has energy, proteins, vitamins, minerals, and fiber which you need. And no single food is going to supply all this. So it should be a well-balanced diet. Avoid smoking, avoid tobacco smoking. Very important thing is the type of preparation of the food. So use low fat, means fish is very good, chicken is good, but how you prepare is very, very important. If you are going to have a fried fish, it just spoils the whole nutritional value of the fish. So use preparations like boiling, grilling, roasting, poaching or steaming instead of deep frying, and limit the intake of foods high in calories and low in nutrition, such as soft drinks, candies and cookies. They give a lot of calorie but zero nutrition. Now in diabetes, the treatment is not only medicine. In fact, I tell half the treatment is diet, half the treatment is medication. So it is very important that you have a very regular diet. You should be eating every 2 to 3 hours because you're on medications which are going to lower the blood sugar level. So if you don't eat on time, your sugar is going to go down. So you need to have a regular meal. What you eat has to be quality. Quantity has to be small because in diabetes, what happens is your body doesn't have the mechanism to control your blood sugar. Like if a normal person has sweets, the body has enough capacity in them to regulate that sugar. But in a diabetic patient, when you take a lot of carbohydrates, when your sugar levels really rise, the body doesn't have the capacity. It's a metabolic disorder. It doesn't have the capacity to control that sugar. And then you get all the side effects of diabetes. So the quantity is also very important. Just because it is healthy food, you cannot have full bowl of it. And small frequent meals, as I said. And never ever skip meals. In diabetes, you need to reduce the carbohydrate intake. You cannot completely stop it because majority of the calorie what we get is through carbohydrate. But what kind of carbohydrates you eat, that is very, very important. More the fiber in the diet, better, because the glucose levels rise steadily then. And then the body is able to take care of that glucose level. When it should be low fat, it should be high fiber, and there should be a lot of mineral and vitamin supplementation. What you should avoid? Sugar in any form, even honey, because in the end it is sweet. So just because it is a better form of sugar, you cannot have it. Glucose in any form, jaggery, any food which is made from refined, anything which is refined is devoid of the fiber. So the more refined you take, the less fiber you're eating. So you have to avoid refined flour, maida. Fruit juices is absolute no in diabetics or even any other normal person also. Because you throw off all the fiber and you drink only the sugar water. Only person who doesn't have teeth should opt for fruit juices. Every other person should eat the whole fruit. And red meat has to be avoided because it has a lot of saturated fats. What you should restrict? Potatoes, sweet potatoes. Fruits like banana, mango, chiku, custard apple, these are very, very high in calorie and sugar content. And rice to be taken in limited quantities. Now, many people are rice eaters, so you cannot ask them one fine day, you just stop all the rice. So you can eat in moderation. See that you're eating the parboiled rice, not the refined or basmati or polished rice. Go for brown rice or boiled rice. What you can have liberally, green leafy vegetables, clear soups, whole grain cereals and pulses, baked, grilled, roasted, boiled foods. Once you have diabetes, what you need to do is get your blood sugar level checked. And every 3 to 6 monthly, get an average blood sugar level, which is the HbA1c, to see exactly, you know, how your diabetes is doing. Because many times, maybe you have eaten something in the last few days, and the sugar goes up. But if your HbA1c level is quite well under control, then you're okay, this is a temporary thing and maybe the next reading is going to be fine. Or today your blood sugar is perfectly fine, but your HbA1c is like 10. That means last 6 months you have not kept your sugar under control. Lipid profile should be checked every 3 to 6 monthly, depending on how your levels are. Kidney and liver function have to be checked every 6 monthly. ECG at least once a year, stress test at least once a year, and urine examination every 3 to 6 monthly to look for any protein loss. Now, treatment of diabetes. What, as I already told you, in type 2 diabetes, treatment is mainly tablets. Unless sugar is very, very high, then we think about starting them at insulin or then an emergency, like patient has to undergo a surgery. Tablets will take some time to act. So that is the time we may put the patient on insulin. Or if the patient is in some acute crisis situation, has come with an infection, is in the ICU due to some other cause, then it is much easier to control with insulin than with tablet. So many other factors which affect your absorption, drug-drug interaction. So insulin is very convenient to use. And it doesn't mean that once we have put you on insulin, you will be dependent on insulin all your life. There's nothing like that. So it is just a temporary thing till you come out of the crisis and then we put you back on oral medications. And of course, supportive therapy for all other complications of diabetes. If you have heart disease, drugs for that. If you have kidney disease, drugs for that. What monitoring you need to do when you have diabetes? Regular blood glucose monitoring. It is very important that you self-monitor your blood glucose level, SMBG, what we say. So every person should check their blood sugar level themselves at home with a glucometer. Now, glucometer is quite reliable. There may be a difference of few points between the lab and the glucometer reading, but it gives a fairly good idea about what is your sugar level. So once they do start doing it at home, you are in much better control of your diabetes. Very important, you should also know the signs of hypoglycemia. Because once you're taking a medicine, you should also know the side effect and how to correct that and recognize that. So generally when someone gets hypoglycemia, they may get profuse sweating, they'll be craving for food, and sometimes you may feel dizzy, uneasy. Sometimes when you get this hypoglycemia in the night, they may just present like a bad dream. So if you've lately started getting some very bad dreams in the night, it could be a sign of hypoglycemia. So you should be aware of all these signs, so that you can approach your doctor, either you reduce the dose or make some alterations in the treatment, or maybe your diet is not right, you're keeping too long gaps between meals and things. You should get your urine, eye testing done, a lipid profile, and foot care, very, very important in diabetics. As I explained to you why they are more prone for these injuries and ulcers. So always wear comfortable clothing, footwear. So nothing which will hurt, so less of all these shoe bites which you get, that should be avoided. You should wear socks if possible and cotton ones so that they can absorb the sweat. If you have used any other material, then they will cause more infections than protect you. Now at the end, as I told you, I'm going to just cover some frequently asked questions or myths and facts, conceptions, misconceptions, which I have got from my day-to-day practice with patients. So most of them, I think of you, will also have these questions, and if you have anything more, then we'll tackle it at the end of the talk. Very frequently patients say, I never eat sugar, so how can I ever get diabetes? But it is not so. Some person may have all the sweets and will never get diabetes, and you may never eat sweets and you will get diabetes. That's because it's a metabolic problem. There are a lot of factors, genetic, lifestyle, which come into play and cause diabetes. So what you eat normally is not the cause for the diabetes. This blood pressure is normal for my age. So as I told you, as we age, our blood pressure starts rising. But it does not mean that it is normal. We have to keep it under control with medications. No symptoms means no disease. Most of the people want to accept this fact, but it is not right. As I said, 67% of the patients with hypertension are unaware that they have hypertension, and 50% of the diabetic patients are unaware that they have diabetes. So you need to undergo regular health checkups to find out whether you have an asymptomatic disease. Diabetes and hypertension is a disease of the old. There's this study which says that it can happen, almost 67% of the patients are diagnosed before the age of 45. And if you see, almost 18% of the patients die before the age of 50 with these diseases. So it is no more a disease of the old, and anyone above the age of 20, 25 can be affected with this disease. These diseases cannot be prevented. So if this cannot be prevented, I can do what I wish, and when I get the disease, I will see what to do about it. That's not the right attitude. These are lifestyle diseases, and lifestyle modification can definitely help prevent these diseases. At some point, you may get it, but it will be much later. The complications will be much, much less. Very common thing. Now that my BP and sugar is under control, can I stop? Can I reduce my medicines? There is so much averseness to continuing a medicine in patients. I see so much resistance sometimes. Doctor, can I reduce? Can I stop now? No, these diseases are not curable. We can only control them. Once you reduce the dose, over a few months, again you will start getting the same problem. So you cannot reduce or stop the medication. Of course, there is a certain class of patients, like a person who's very obese has come to me today with high cholesterol, high blood pressure, high sugars. In them, we start with medicines. We ask them to start with lifestyle modification. Once they have reached, like lost 30 kgs, things are all under control. Once we can give them a trial of stopping the medication. But close monitoring is required. Once you stop medication, you have to do a very regular checkup to see that it is not coming back again. If it comes back again, then next time you should never take up this chance. But all this should be done in consultation with a doctor and under close monitoring. Will I get dependent? This is a very, very, you know, common word which I hear from the patient. Will I get dependent on insulin? Will I get dependent on this medicine? Asthmatic patient, will I get dependent on an inhaler? It is not dependence, it is your requirement. You need to take this medicine to control your things. It is not a drug where if you don't take, you will start getting a withdrawal symptom. That is dependence. This is your requirement. So there is nothing called as dependence. A doctor's group, wherein, you know, patients don't care when they drink Coke about the side effects of that black liquid. When they eat pani puri outside, they're not bothered. Huh? But whenever doctor prescribes a drug, my God, doctor, what are going to be the side effects of this drug? So they're always worried about this. So I think, and any doctor who puts you on a medication is well aware of the side effects. And they will keep a watch for it. And sometimes it doesn't make sense also to list down all the side effects because patients will start imagining things. I've seen that. The moment you tell them, next time, doctor, now I'm having this problem, now I'm that problem, you know. So we do tell some of the side effects, but we don't go on telling them all the effects because they are going to start thinking only about the side effects. Huh. Now, another thing. Doctor, I have been taking this medicine for many years now. Should I change it? There is no such need. If you are well controlled on a drug, it is okay to continue that even lifelong. But if your risk factors have changed, like you were on a medication for hypertension, you suffered a heart attack in between, then of course we may think about changing the drug which will suit both your heart as well as the blood pressure. So let the doctor take that call. There is no need to go on changing your medications every few years. Another thing, when did you last check your sugar? Yeah, I did one check with my glucometer and they are quite okay. And they feel very happy about it. Which reading have you done? One is random, some 1 hour after a meal, one immediate. This reading was high, but I did it immediately after my meal. So the reading is high. I did a fasting, never did a PP. So patients feel very, very safe with that. Because they have excuses for all the abnormal readings which they get. This is not right at all. You need to, even if you're checking your sugars at home with a glucometer, it is very important that you do a proper lab check every 2 to 3 months to see exactly where you fall into. And most other things. You don't see patient for ages and then they come when they have a problem. It is very important, even if you're feeling perfectly fine, every 3 to 6 monthly, at least visit the doctor who will check you up, check all the other parameters which you may be completely unaware of. So if you see this slide, 90% of the people with uncontrolled diabetes believe their blood sugar is under control. In Mumbai, this figure is 92%. And monitoring was considered important only by 13% of the respondents. So this is what is the state of monitoring in Mumbai. This I have already cleared in my first this thing, that diabetic complications are seen very late in the disease. This is a complete myth and it can occur right at the onset. Pre-diabetes has no risk factors for complications. So like if I have an impaired glucose tolerance, I can just still wait till I get diabetes and then I will start working on it. Not right at all. So if you see this slide, you will see 50% of the newly presenting patient with type 2 diabetes already have one or more complications at diagnosis. When doctor advises insulin, end of the world, there is nothing beyond this. People get such a shock. No, doctor, can we try some other tablet? Is there any other way out? I just don't want to take insulin. So there's such a resistance to take insulin, but sometimes that can really do wonders to you. When at a stage where your body is not producing enough insulin, if you take insulin, it can really get down your sugars. In fact, sometimes your medicines also come down. And other situations, like, you know, it improves your beta cell function, It reverses the insulin resistance in some patients. It has a beneficial effects on lipids. And overall, it improves your quality of life. So if a doctor advises the insulin, there are reasons for it and you should go away. In fact, nowadays we have long-acting insulins available, which can be taken only once a day. So you need not take it before every meal also. So there are very convenient doses which are available, less side effects. Pens are available, so the prick is hardly even, patient don't even feel the prick. Now, in the end, I have just put forth certain points, like when should you approach, like which symptoms you should recognize and approach a doctor. When you have rapid weight loss, this is one of the symptoms which I have seen with diabetic patients. Rapid weight loss in the last 2-3 months, up to 7 to 8 kgs sometimes. This can be one of the signs of diabetes. Increased thirst and urination. Nocturia, that means passing urine in the night. Any new onset headache which you never had, or heaviness of the head and dizziness, this may be a sign of hypertension. Now, red flag signs, these are dangerous signals. Where you should not wait, you should immediately rush to a doctor. Whenever you have any chest discomfort associated with profuse sweating, lot of sweating, this is one of the signs of a heart attack which is happening. So you should rush to a doctor. Gas symptoms not getting better. Most of these patients with ischemic heart disease, they present more like gas symptoms. Abdominal discomfort, belching, uneasiness. And if these symptoms are not getting better with antacids and other things, you should always go and get an ECG done. Especially with diabetics, as I told you, they never get pain. So they get all these other symptoms. Chest pain after food. This is a type of angina. And you should be very careful and you should recognize this symptom and approach a doctor. Whenever you start getting swelling in the feet, there can be two causes of this. One, in a diabetic patient, if you are losing so much protein in your urine or the kidneys are already affected, they are not able to manage your fluid in the body, they start getting swelling in the feet. Other thing could be if your heart function has gone down drastically. Again, they start getting swelling in the feet. Any patient who has sudden onset breathlessness, again, this can be a sign of heart attack itself or a heart failure. And breathlessness on lying down. We call it paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea or orthopnea, wherein a person is comfortable when they are sitting. But the moment they lie down, they start feeling breathless. Especially when they go off to sleep around 2 to 3 a.m., they need to get up in the middle of the night and go and catch some breath. This is the earliest sign of heart failure. And you should be aware of this. Whenever you experience the worst headache of your life, I think Rashmi had something like this. And that is a sign of probably a hemorrhage in your brain. So you should always go to the casualty or the emergency doctor and see immediately. Temporary vision loss. Like for a moment you felt you lost your vision or couldn't see one side of the house or room or whatever. Weakness, tingling, numbness. For a brief moment, some abnormal movements of the face, hands. These are all signs of an impending larger stroke which is going to come. So you have to be conscious of all these things. And if there's anything like this, you should go and see a doctor so that we can prevent a bigger attack coming. A rapidly declining memory loss. Again, this is not a red flag sign, but if it is rapidly going down, it may be a sign of diabetes, hypertension causing ischemia in the head and causing not Alzheimer's, but dementia. Severe abdominal pain, which is not getting corrected with anything. This is one of the signs, in fact, a non-surgical cause of abdominal pain where patients go into diabetic ketoacidosis. When the diabetes goes to such a level that you start producing acid in the body, that one of the signs is severe abdominal pain. So when you go to a doctor, severe pain, sonography normal, blood reports normal, we should always check the sugars and the ketone levels in these patients. And this one, I think, I don't know whether you're aware, decreasing dose of diabetic medication. You have been on the medication for a very long time. And off late started getting hypoglycemia on the same dose. Or doctor has started reducing your medicine dose without checking your renal profile. So this is a sign of renal involvement, because as your kidneys start getting affected, you excrete the dose much, much slower. So the dose remains in the circulation for a longer period of time, and you're well controlled with a lower dose. In fact, patients are so happy and come and tell, "Doctor, now I no more need my diabetic medications." But I said, this is a sign that your kidneys are completely knocked off. Okay, so you have to remember this sign. With all this, I'm sure everyone is depressed about how do I live my life now. But I think it is very important to know that living with diabetes and hypertension is not much different from living a very healthy lifestyle. Your eating and exercise plans are the same as anyone else who wants to be healthy in life. So although you can't cure diabetes and hypertension, through healthy living, you can keep it under control. Thank you very much. If any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Anybody? Yeah.
Can we control blood pressure by taking blood thinner aspirin?
No, not at all. Blood thinners is to thin down your blood. It has an antiplatelet action. It has got nothing to do with blood pressure.
No, but doctor advised to take blood thinner daily.
Yeah, that either you have been documented with a heart disease, a block, or it's prophylactic. Okay. At this age, with high lipids, high blood pressure, you give an aspirin dose to prevent any clot formation. But that does not get down your blood pressure.
Thank you.
Okay, this one of the drugs which doctors talk in case of diabetes, metformin. There has been some support that metformin affects adversely absorption of vitamin D in the body. Is there a truth in that?
I really don't want to believe all these reports. If you see a newspaper, every 3 months, the same thing which was bad will be good, you know, after 3 months if you read the report. So, till now there is no such data, and I think we should not believe this.
It's only rumor. It came in the newspaper.
We don't
only.
Know. See, science is always evolving. So, yeah. I don't think we can, and we ourselves have also not understood our body so well. So, things are going to be changing. We should wait for evidence.
And the thing is, while testing this blood sugar by glucometer at home, many times a pinch is made and it is pressed. Blood comes. Does pressing make the blood diluter and gives a wrong
if
reading?
If you press too much, yes, it can affect. So the best thing is you have to first press your finger and then do the prick. Rather than first pricking and then pressing your finger.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can we have medication along with the restricted food?
Means diet control with medication?
No, no. Medication then? For diabetes. There are food which are restricted for diabetes.
Which are? No, not at all, not at all. You cannot have a sweet and then take insulin over it. Damage is already done.
Okay, you mentioned that painkillers, and amongst those you mentioned was also aspirin, which he also asked.
Yeah,
can
now see,
increase,
there are different doses.
Increase BP?
What we use for...
Ecosprin kind of a thing?
Yes. Now, Ecosprin is 75 milligram.
That's right.
So, when we use... Aspirin has different effects at different doses. At 75, it has antiplatelet activity.
Okay, the second
so
thing...
So, higher doses which we use for pain, that is the one...
Yeah, the second question I had was, I read somewhere that prolonged use of statins has led to diabetes... in many patients.
Yeah, even I've been hearing from my patients quite a bit recently. I think this has come up very recently. But I don't think, as I said, we have to wait. It has proven much more benefit than what reports we are reading now.
Can I have a third question also then? In that case, you said HbA1c can be normal, but the same patient can have high blood sugar and hyperglycemia at the same time over a period of time.
Yes.
And that's a red flag. Why?
Not a red flag.
Yeah, in your red flags that was mentioned hyperglycemia also.
Back. I don't think so. HbA1c was not mentioned in the red flag at all. Nothing here. So, see, basically HbA1c is something which tells you your overall
average.
Control of sugar. So,
average.
So yes, yes. In the last few days, he can have a hypoglycemia, he can have a hyperglycemia.
Uh, Regarding the latest studies on cholesterol, and earlier you used to find cholesterol as one of the top dangers that affect a healthy lifestyle, and now cholesterol has really come down in the sense sugar is supposed to be the major threat. What's your view on the cholesterol part?
See, as I mentioned that slide on the risk factors,
yeah,
they are all interlinked and they are equally important. So just taking care of your sugar and not looking at the lipids at all doesn't make sense. But of course, diabetes has got much more effects on many more aspects or many other metabolic processes, including the lipids. Means even in diabetic patients, a normal lipid is not considered normal. You have to treat that. Okay. It's that way.
Okay. So two other questions. You mentioned about the type 2 diabetes, which is also one of the diabetes which is genetic in nature. Is there
may
any
or may not.
Huh? Is there any study that, okay, one of the parent is diabetic and...
It's a very old thing. If you have, a strong family history of diabetes, you are more prone. But how much is the percentage and how much it's going to come to you? Sometimes your parents are not diabetic, or grandparents may be diabetic. And okay, you may get the gene from there. Because there are so many other factors which make your gene, phenotype, for the gene phenotype to come about, to really... gene to manifest as a disease. There are many other factors which happen.
And the last one you mentioned, you mentioned about honey here. Huh. And are you actually classifying all honeys not to be touched?
Yes,
or are you saying natural honey.
Honey,
which is the real natural one?
It means all honey. It means they say sugar is okay, refined from sugar cane. But honey is something natural. Can we? No, you cannot.
What about the sugar juices you said? Because sugar juices, one are which come in the packs and the other one which we take out at our home from fresh fruits. Because they are not having the added sugar.
Both. Because see what happens when you take a glass of juice. One, you are not using one fruit. If you have to take an orange juice also, which is permitted in diabetic, orange is permitted as a fruit. So you need at least 3 oranges to make a glass of juice. Okay? You throw away all the fiber. So when you drink that orange juice, your blood sugar, because there is nothing to process, there is nothing to digest. The moment the juice enters your body, your sugar goes up like this. Then the body has to make all the efforts to get down that sugar. When you eat the whole fruit, one, the quantity is less, there's a fiber. So the blood sugar, when it rises, it's a very, very slow and steady rise, which your body is able to manage, the medications is able to manage. So that's the reason. And plus, fiber removes a lot of toxins, it gives roughage, a lot of benefits of having fiber.
No. Also, the fruit sugar is, fruits contain fructose.
Hmm.
Fructose is a much safer sugar as compared to the sugar that we are all eating,
yeah,
as starch or any other sugar. And when you juice the fruits, you break the fructose down. That is even worse than your regular sugars. So when you break the fructose down, it causes a very large surge in your blood sugar levels. So fruit juices are not allowed. Whereas fruits with pure fructose is much safer. You understand? So there is a lot of difference in eating starch, fruits, and fruit juices. Three different things.
Thank you. Thank you, Tomi.
I have two questions. One is, what about vegetable juices? So if you use a juicer for...
You can. If you want to mix 2-3 things together, you can.
We don't
but only thing, whenever you make a juice, you're breaking down the fiber. So your fiber content will go down.
Second question is, this is a different one. Especially when we go to the doctors, we follow one doctor and we typically go to them. So when the parents, especially in today's world, when they're traveling, whenever we want to show to some other doctor, there's a resistance. And even if you go to the doctor with entire files, doctors don't follow that. They give some of the medicine all the way. And that becomes
individual.
A challenge.
It is individual, but as far as possible, doctors should follow what is going on, unless there's something very contradictory or very drastic, because the earlier doctor has seen the patient right from the beginning. If the patient has been on 4 antihypertensives, today you find the blood pressure to be normal and you say, why are you taking so many drugs and just cancel, it's not right. I think doctors have to take a call on that.
I have one question.
See, both have their value.
Sometimes it happens that our blood sugar level is H1LC within the limit, but fasting and post sugar
Maybe last 6 months you were under very good control, but last 1 month was mango season. I had lot of mangoes, so your sugar will go up this time.
But that doctor said in mango season you are going to be more diabetic. It happens in every season.
Hello. Doctor, I have a very, very basic question. You have mentioned that both the diseases are incurable, but they should be controlled. My question basically pertains to blood pressure now. What medication, whatever you give, suppose blood pressure high, you want to control it, you are giving certain medication. These medicines, what do they do in a system so that the blood
becomes... There are different mechanisms of action. So many of them are vasodilators. Relax your blood vessels.
Before you answer, one more thing, because people say, or it has been known that why this blood pressure occurs or happens, that there is no, you know, valid reasons or causes.
Reasons mean there are reasons like, as I told you, as we age, our blood vessels become more and more stiff. So when the heart has to pump, it has to pump with a much more pressure so that the blood flows into the system and reaches the organs. So that is one mechanism. When our cholesterol is very high, the vessel wall is lined with these plaques. Yeah. So again, the pressure inside, the resistance inside. So there is a cause for blood pressure.
I have one more question. Yeah. You said drinking is not good for the diabetic.
For anyone.
For anyone. But some doctors say little drinking is required because of thinning of the blood.
No, not thinning, relaxation. But the risk involved or the chance which you are taking for that alcohol to relax your blood pressure is much, much more for the liver disease you will suffer, lipid, you know, dysregulation which you will have. So it's not worth it.
So we, doctor, we have to follow.
Yeah, but it's very difficult to define a small quantity. When we say frequently, it may be... See, there are reports which say that small quantities of alcohol do relax the blood vessels, but that cannot be promoted as a lifestyle change or a therapeutic modality.
It's better not to have.
Yeah, but people who want to take that excuse and have, then doctors can do nothing about it.
Doctor, I have a couple of questions. One is this, I have seen this situation in a lot of families where one parent is diabetic. As a result, the girl child develops PCOD, so polycystic ovarian disease, which leads to a lot of conception issues. So is that a real thing that I've read, or is it only a myth?
Not only diabetes, it is a lifestyle disease. Like, we are seeing a lot of PCOS, which is, I think madam will be able to answer that better. So a lot of people who are developing this because of the lifestyle, obesity, and the stress and the lifestyle. Which
basically, PCOD is it's not a genetic
I'm basically a gynecologist. See, what happens is, this is a very, very real situation, what he's talking about. Our parents had diabetes or have diabetes at the age of 60, 70. Our generation has it in 40, 50s. Let's be honest. The next generation is going to get it in their 30s. There's no two ways about it. And PCOD is one of the results of the lifestyle, you know, that you all are having now. You'll never find young girls playing around like how we used to play. You never find them playing catch and cook or lagoris or anything. There's no skipping rope outside. That's because in their teens, you hardly find any children exercising. So all of them are much more obese as compared to what they should be. You will find girls at the age of 14, 15, 16, 18, already 60 kilos of age, of weight. 60 kilos is out of question. They should be anywhere between 35 to 40 kilos. And 35 to 40 kilos is, mera bachcha itna weak hai. You know, you can't imagine a 40 kilo girl coming to me and then their mother and father profusely sweating, saying that she's not eating anything. And she doesn't need to eat because she's not exercising. So PCOD is a metabolic syndrome disease. It is the manifestation of your coming diabetes. This girl is going to get diabetes in the next 20 years of her life. it's scary, but it's a fact. They do not exercise, they eat rubbish, there is so much of dietary bad influence coming on them, so they just have no choice. They have been taught to eat that. Let's be honest, we take our children out every week and the children do not know that they should not be eating the pizza because we have taught them that. So I'm talking about even younger children who are just trained to do that. So please, if you change your lifestyles and your diets, your future generation, your children, your grandchildren will all be in a much better regime, much better place. India has the third largest amount of diabetics in the world. And this is one place we don't want to become the first.
We are the first.
This is even more scary. Honestly, very true. I was just still hoping we are the third.
We are the first, leading the way.
The population and yeah.
Doctor, one more question, doctor. Thank you, doctor. One more question was, you know, the concept of the, you know, glycemic index of food. So when people have full meal and then they have sweet or fruit along with food, so does it increase glycemic load?
Yeah, it will definitely increase.
And then, so does it cause diabetes or lead to diabetes or lead to lipid derangement, yeah, because you are
See,
combining
diabetes
fruit?
Diabetes is multifactorial. Like there has to be genetic predisposition, many other factors. So not everyone who will have so much of sweet will develop diabetes. But of course, the high blood sugar during that time will increase your triglycerides, will play havoc with your lipids, and that eventually will lead to all the problems that you will have. So it is.
The type of medication, now there is a lot of research going on in respect of biosimilars, which primarily pertains to drugs similar to antibodies produced in the body. Is there any scope that any biosimilar which can rather relate to diabetics can, which primarily will not be without any, with no ill side effects? They will not have side effects because you are not entering some foreign chemical into the body.
No, but see,
it is same what is being produced in the body.
Biosimilars will have some effects. Means, like I am a rheumatologist, so I use a lot of biosimilars in rheumatology because of autoimmune disorder and you need to suppress the immune system. But none of the drug till now produced is without side effects.
They're still at a very infancy state currently.
Very infancy state currently. Still
but
not
I'm looking
even reached
ahead.
A stage where we have been able to produce oral insulin. We are still so far off. So we are still way, way behind.
Doctor, just one. How do you explain triglycerides in very, very thin people, very high and
genetic. Indians are genetically made in which they have a genotype where they have high triglycerides and low HDL level. So many people who are very thin built, exercising, having a very good lifestyle may still have very high triglycerides. It is in fact familial hypertriglyceridemia.
And it's similar with the like PCOD, people who are totally non-obese, I mean ladies who are totally non-obese but still...
Rarely we find that. Most of them, 90% and above, will be obese. Like one of the features of the PCOS syndrome is obesity. And they will have insulin resistance.
Okay. Yeah, question.
That's absolutely wrong. Absolutely wrong.
Okay. Last two, three.
Yeah.
Could you mention something about low blood pressure because you've spoken of high BP?
Yeah, now low blood pressure, many patients come, I have low blood pressure. But actually many females or some people may have BP up to 90, 60 as a normal blood pressure. Low blood pressure is not a person, I mean we don't really look at it from a disease point of view and a normal OPD day. Because low blood pressure, we call it as hypotension, and it's a very dangerous sign when patient comes with infection, heart failure and things. So when a patient has 90, 60 BP and is walking and coming, that is a normal blood pressure and should accept that. So we are not really worried about low blood pressure in normal day-to-day life. That's a normal blood pressure and you should accept your blood pressure.
So if the person has a blood pressure, say 110 or 70?
That's normal for them, yeah.
Gets to 120, 130, will he get a headache or some?
No, not really. It has to cross the 140-90 mark. Some may not get any symptom even at 200. So it's individual.
Doctor, one question. You said that it's fine to have a low BP. But recently, one of the doctors told me that, you know, the exercise factor has to be less if you have low BP because you might get...
No.
Yeah, because I have had been told that. So no, that's why I'm asking about
this. It's not right
this.
At all.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Does low BP cause sleepiness?
No. Yeah, just keep yourself well hydrated. That is important. But there are enough mechanisms in the body. See, at whatever values we have, blood pressure, blood sugar, heart rate, there are many hormones, systems working in the body to maintain at that level. So just because you have 90-60 BP and you start working out, your BP is not going to crash there. There are so many hormones which are released into the body which will constrict your vessels, pull up your blood pressure and things. So body
which
has
is, which is
lot
why
of mechanisms.
We've not been seeing her in the garden. Lately I was wondering why she's not coming.
That's because of the rain.
Any other question? Should be.